multiple listening sessions to hear from our community and some staff. I know that we have some staff joining us tonight. And the purpose of our meeting tonight is to share a little information about the new state guidelines on reopening schools and share with you some of the factors that we're considering in Park Rose. And then I'd like to be sure to make sure that we're answering any questions that you folks have tonight. So thanks again for being here. You can head to the next slide, Sarah, thanks. So wanna make sure if you need to access interpretation that you can see the on your Mac or PC, the globe. And then if you're on your phone, the little three dots symbol. So I'll talk a little bit about the goals for tonight. I want to share updates to the state guidelines for school reopening for in-person hybrid instruction. I'd like to discuss model of instruction for in-person instruction to tell you what would it look like in Park Rose so you know if when we go back to in-person instruction, some of the challenges and how it would be different from what we're currently doing with distance learning. And the most important goal is to listen and respond to questions, answers, and concerns from our community and from our staff. And that is my hope tonight. So thanks again for being here. So to let everyone know, one important piece to share is that last week, our school board voted to extend comprehensive distance learning to March 29th. And that is due to high community spread and the disproportionate impact of COVID-19 in Park Rose. However, we are here to listen and determine if when we begin providing in-person instruction beyond, beyond the month of March. We spent a lot of time discussing it at our board meeting last week, and I'll share some of the factors tonight as to why we extended that to March 29th. So this is a very official looking guideline sheet. I'm not going to talk specifically too much to this, but this is, and I will put in the chat, the more comprehensive Ready Schools Safe Learners Guidelines. It's a very long document with over 160 requirements for schools to reopen. I know that many of you have seen on the news or read in the newspaper, hey, schools can reopen. They can reopen based on these metrics that are now called advisory, but there's also many other things that schools are required to do to provide in-person instruction. So I wanna talk a little bit about those. You can go to the next slide. The recent guidelines that were released relaxed the metrics. So in the fall, when we began school, we were required to have less than 50 cases of COVID-19 per 100,000 residents. The recent change just a few days ago, in order to provide elementary on-site, we have to be between 200 and 350 cases per 100,000. Some of the research that's been done, obviously it's very dynamic because we're learning more about the virus, and these metrics are closer to what other states around us are using to determine whether or not to open schools. Cases that are 350 per 100,000 or more, these advisory metrics recommend that we stay in distance learning. So today's metrics, the last 2 weeks, the last 14 days, we're averaging about 300 cases per 100,000. Last week, we were at 342, which is really the primary reason that our board and myself were not comfortable making plans in the near future to reopen. You can go to the next slide. So here are some of the things that we have been doing as a district to help us determine the risk that our community faces by opening schools. As I mentioned, we're just slightly under 300 cases per 100,000 currently. One of the most important impacts for Park Rose is that we have a disproportionate impact on our community of color. So in general, infection rates are 3 times higher than white residents. So our families of color in Park Rose are experiencing higher infection rates, as well as higher rates of hospitalization, and unfortunately higher rates of death. This makes up about 70% of our student population are students of color. And then of course, we take very serious the working conditions for our employees. I think most important is our employees, particularly our teachers, have done a lot of preparation and spent a lot of time building the routines for comprehensive distance learning. And as I will speak to in a few minutes, there are a lot of things that would be different for in-person instruction following the guidelines that we've received from the state of Oregon. I will ask if you have questions that come to mind and you don't want to wait until the end of the slideshow because the slides won't take much longer. You're welcome to put questions in the chat, even concerns in the chat, and we will capture that and be sure to try to answer all the questions once we're through the slides. So some of the things that are in the guidelines that are critical to controlling risk. So if when we are reopening to students, we're required to provide 35 square feet per student, which in turn means, you can go to the next one, Sarah. This allows for about 13 to 14 students per classroom based on the size of our rooms. We'd have to have social distancing in all settings and monitor that. We'd have to limit cohort sizes. What that means is the highest cohort we can have is 100 students, which means that you know your child could not be in contact with more than 100 students in a day. And so the recommendation is 36 students. And at elementary school, it's a little less difficult. At middle school and high school, it's very difficult to limit cohort sizes to less than 100 because they attend multiple classes. Go to the next bullet. So there are multiple what we call contact tracing protocols in place, meaning that the school district and our county, Multnomah County, is responsible for reporting infections and have to trace those infections so that we would know to be able to notify our staff and the community about an infection. It is important to know that in a school, we would not be telling families or staff who the people are that are infected. We would only be reporting to them that they were exposed to the virus. And that they, depending on the level of exposure, we would recommend a quarantine for that student or a group of students and staff. That is one of the risks because when there is an infection, that could impact the whole school, it could impact a classroom. It just depends on the situation. There are ventilation standards so that when schools do start to have students come back, not only do we have to upgrade our ventilation, meaning we're running our ventilation more, higher grade filters, as well as in those rooms that have windows, we would bring in as much fresh air as we could to keep airflow going. That would also include leaving classroom doors open so that there is a flow of air more regularly. Teachers, staff, custodians would be responsible for many protocols with surface cleaning throughout the school. So one critical factor is when students are at school, we would, when they leave a space, their classroom, for instance, and they come back, it is required that we clean surfaces in between times kids are in the classroom. One thing that is still a little unclear, but we do know that if we open in a higher risk time, like right now, we would have to have rapid testing available at the schools, which would require staff to be able to provide the rapid test to students. These rapid tests are actually able to be done by the person unless the student has a disability. So that is a new piece to the guidelines that we just learned the other day. And vaccinations for staff. So you likely have seen on the news about educators being vaccinated in the last week. We have learned about the process and are still learning about the process. And you will see that next week across the Tri-County area, Multnomah, Washington, and Clackamas County, we will start vaccinating staff. It won't be required of staff, but staff will receive information to sign up for the vaccine. So you know, this vaccine is a two-dose vaccine. So it will take well over a month for all staff to get their first dose. And then depending on the vaccine they receive, there are two vaccines. One is Pfizer, one is Moderna. One is a 3-week wait before the second dose, and the other is a 4-week wait. And about 2 weeks after the second dose is deemed when folks, the vaccination has the highest effectiveness against COVID-19. So of course, some of the problem solving issues that we're talking about in our district is maintaining social distancing requirements. How do you do that? Based on the number of students we have, in-person instruction would allow for each student to attend 2 days of school of in-person instruction. That assumes all kids come back, and we know that many families may not be comfortable sending their child back. And that also means that teachers are providing 2 days of in-person instruction to one group of students and then two days to another group. And of course, we have to factor in that there are fairly intensive cleaning protocols and planning and preparation that teachers would need. Frankly, just to be honest with this group tonight, it is challenging at all levels, but it's exceptionally challenging at the middle school and high school level. So complex because of the number of students. That is definitely something we're problem solving and considering when we think about whether or not we go back to in-person instruction. Students, when they're not at school, would be working on what we call asynchronous work. So that means that they would be assigned work. There would not be able to be regular synchronous support from staff like you see now in distance learning, simply because teachers will be with kids. So that makes it more challenging, more difficult. So that's another significant change that we would have to figure out. Go to the next bullet. And the other complex challenge is students who don't choose to attend in person would either be assigned to a new teacher for online instruction or receive less online instruction, either or. It is a monumental task and actually, frankly, a little scary to think about asking teachers to do in-person instruction 4 days a week and monitor and support online instruction, particularly when, in many of our classrooms, we have 25 to 30 students. But ultimately, in order to provide the social distancing, I do not believe that it's appropriate to ask our community to attend school and have that only be the choice during this pandemic. And frankly, it would be less instructional time than we're providing now on a day-to-day basis, at the elementary level in particular. Go to the next slide. Just a couple more, and then I'll be able to get to some of the questions that are coming up. Transportation. So one other piece that's a factor is, due to cohort limits, we can have about 25 to 30 students on a bus. We would have to limit transportation. We couldn't provide transportation to the families that all receive transportation right now, simply because we don't have the number of buses or drivers to get to kids to school on time. Because normally some of our school buses are full and they fit 60 to 65 kids. We wouldn't have the capacity to run multiple buses throughout the morning to get to kids to school on time. Meals, we would have to, we are considering and figuring out how would we feed students on site and also provide food for students who aren't on site, because currently we are providing food for students each day. And I encourage you, if you're not accessing the food at school, we do encourage families to, we are delivering to bus stops in the community, and we're starting a program to deliver to some of the apartment complexes out in the community. But that is another factor. And then of course, contact tracing. Obviously, one of the concerns I have for families and for staff is, I don't want to speak about safety tonight. I just want to talk about risk, because it really is monitoring the level of risk that is involved in going back to school in person. We can't guarantee a perfect safe environment simply because it is a virus. All of these factors that I'm sharing with you do help mitigate the chances of someone being infected. However, infections do happen. And if in the case there was an exposure, there is the potential that we would have to go temporarily go back to CDL, or there could be the scenario of a spike and we reach beyond, you know, we get to higher risk levels in our county. And that's definitely was a concern of our board in our conversation last week. All right, next slide. So next steps, and then I'll answer some questions. Tonight's one of those steps. I want to make sure that I am hearing from our families who are ready for school to start, and our families who are really concerned about school from starting, and our families who feel indifferent and not sure what to do. But I think it is important to listen to our community. We have multiple teams that are reviewing these guidelines that I've shared with you tonight. And planning for what it would look like, you know, and more importantly, what are the critical factors for Park Rose? What conditions do we think we need in order to start bringing students back? Because whatever decision we make, you know, in the spring, it will be based on these factors that are authentic to Park Rose and the impact that Park Rose has had to deal with regarding the pandemic. We will survey and formally reach out to families in late February just to determine who intends to return in person based on the state and the district's reopening guidelines. Earlier in the year, we only had about half of the families that said they were intending to come back. And that was before we had a lot higher community spread. So that is a real challenge for school districts, particularly ours being a smaller school district, to serve multiple needs in person and online. Let me take a moment to see if there are questions. And I think what I'll do is I can go through the chat here. And then for our interpreters, if you have a question, you know, please let us know. I see that there is one question in Spanish in the chat. So I'm gonna just start from Manuel's question. Do students need to be vaccinated before returning to school? Right now, for students who are 16 and younger, the vaccine is not available to them. And kids 16 and older actually won't be in line for the vaccination till much later in the year. I think that it'll probably be late spring before 16 to 18 year olds will have access to the vaccination. The CDC and the FDA has not approved the vaccine for students younger than 15. They are doing research and determining whether it is safe for students, but it will not be a requirement. And it's not a requirement for teachers, but we are advising our staff, all of our staff, that being vaccinated does help us get to a more safe environment to where there's less likelihood of community spread, particularly within our schools. So ideally in the next month, our staff will begin the vaccination process, and that will take time, but we're starting that very soon. How many families in our district live without health insurance? I know that many of our families are covered by the Oregon Health Plan. I would say that it's fair to say that we do have families, probably a significant percentage, that do not have health insurance. I do want to reiterate that when the vaccine is available to the community, that the vaccine will not cost money and it won't require you to have insurance. The second question, what data is available on virus transmission between children exposed to the novel coronavirus in school and unvaccinated schools and their families? That's a really, really good question, Mike. There is conflicting evidence. And I have spent a lot of time reading the research. And of course, it's very dynamic that it's changing. We're learning more. In the United States, there has not been a lot of deep research around exposure. There is some research, and the reason that these metrics have changed to show that some research has shown that young children, so the reason you're seeing kindergarten, third grade recommendations to start earlier is because it has shown, these particular studies have shown that young children are less likely to transmit the virus, but it doesn't mean that they don't. There's nothing that demonstrates that they don't. And that likelihood, again, there are conflicting studies that are now showing. You probably have seen that schools have started to close in Europe, Western Europe in particular. And the factor there is that they are finding, particularly with the variant, that it is transmissible between children and adults, and they think it's at the same rate. But again, because this virus, even though it feels like it's 20 years old, because we've been enduring this for so long, there is not conclusive evidence. And then how many of our families effectively died in last in line? Oh, who's last in line to receive the vaccine, which means everyone will not be vaccinated before June. Yeah, I wish I had a better answer for vaccination rollout. I know that it's a monstrosity in terms of the logistics, but what I do know is that I can send information out to the community from the Oregon Health Authority that shows the order of who will be available. I do think over the next 2 months, it will be essential workers in different categories. Educators are happening next. I know that the governor delayed more elderly people from being vaccinated, and that starts the second week of February. I believe that by the middle of spring, so April, May, more of the general public will start getting the vaccination. But again, I'm not an expert in the vaccination rollout. I'm learning all about it every day, but that's my best guess at this time. So there definitely is still a level of risk, and that's one of our concerns at the district level. What I saw a slide the other day from a scientist at OHSU about the level of vaccination by the end of August, and it showed about 40 to 50% of total population was the slide I saw. But again, it was a predictive slide. So we are a ways from everyone being vaccinated for sure. see if I can get to the next question. Okay, so I'm gonna come back to your questions, Mike. Give me just one second. So are they having lunch in the classroom or cafeteria? Students would likely eat in the cafeteria. There isn't a rule that they would eat in the room. There were concerns either way. We would have to, one of the things that would school would look like is that students would be, we would discourage students from going to different classrooms. So we would likely not have students go to a lot of other rooms simply because of the risk of changing environments and being exposed to others. It's not always preventable, but we would limit that. And I think the only place we would know they would be going is they would have some outside breaks and they would eat lunch in the cafeteria at the elementary school. Middle school, high school, we're not sure how it worked simply because there's so many students and exposure is more of a concern. Will there be any sports programs this year? Students will be allowed to start conditioning February 1st, only outside and limited to groups of 15. So if things are okay by third week of February, soccer and cross country will be able to be played. And they have a very short season that the students will be able to play. And again, no spectators and a limit to total, including the teams, a total of 50 people. Sports opening is based on different guidelines that I know is confusing, but it's based on the county's risk level, not the school reopening guidelines. So we're having to follow different guidelines around sports, but we will be able to start conditioning kids outside. We cannot do any inside activities at this time due to the community spread. Annie, what future plans does the district have to make up for how far behind kids in CDL are falling compared to their peers who are able to attend school? So I think thank you for asking that question. It's a really important question. One of the things that we're hoping to be able to do is look at, are there ways in the summer that we'll be able to provide some support? And to be honest with you, I think our future conversation should be about, should there be more time in future school years, to help make up for lost time? I guess the other question is that I honestly have professionally is I'm not sure if students going 2 days a week in person is going to be actually, I know quantity wise, it won't be more instruction. It actually will be less instruction than students are getting in CDL, but I know they're very different things. And so that makes it really challenging to compare, the level of instruction kids are getting in hybrid, which would be the 2 days per week, and then they would be doing work at from home, versus having, multiple hours of instruction like they are now in comprehensive distance learning. But I want to recognize your concern that yes, we're very worried about students getting behind. And we're hopeful that some of the dollars we potentially will receive from the federal government will allow us to run summer programs, after school programs that will be able to help us in providing more support to students when we're able to have more students in school. COVID-19 variant. We don't know really the impact of the variant. I was part of a meeting the other day where we heard a scientist from OHU present some data. There definitely is still predicted spikes in the community, particularly in Multnomah County, simply because that's the pattern. That's the pattern that's been going. And the variant has appeared in Oregon, in Multnomah County. We just don't know what that impact's going to be in terms of transmission. But we are still at pretty high rates right now. So that is definitely concerning. Would there need to be opportunities for parents to volunteer? We would love that. I think the challenge under these restrictions is that we won't be able to have volunteers because we have to trace every adult, every kid, and the smaller the groups, the better, because one of the concerns I have about reopening is, Multnomah County's learning how to manage this virus, and contact tracing is a very intense process when we find out there's been an exposure. So I think that there will be opportunities once we are able to start doing some things outside. I do appreciate in the new guidelines that there is some guidance of how we could start doing things outside when the weather warms. And I think that is a place where we could likely use volunteers when we're able to be outside and spread out. Kindergarten and first grade. Yeah, I don't disagree that they definitely have the greatest need to attend, and they will be the first in terms of when we do make the decision to reopen to in-person for hybrid. We would start with youngest students. My genuine question to our staff members and to the community is, as a parent, thinking about my child's a little bit older, but thinking about as a parent, 2 days of school, and again, you'd still be monitoring and supporting at home the other 3 days, weighing the difference, right? Like having that adult attention is so valuable, but I'm just concerned about its limitations. And more importantly, for young kids, in order to serve both needs in person and online, there is the potential, just simply because we don't have the staffing, there'd be the potential that kids would have to change teachers simply because we don't have the staff to, I don't think that it's reasonable for staff to be able to do online teaching simultaneously with in-person instruction. It'd be really hard to do, not impossible, but definitely difficult to do. Is it safe to say that middle school and high school students will continue online schooling for the rest of the year? I'd say that middle school and high school are extremely difficult, and I really question whether or not it would be best for them. One thing, the earlier study question, there is more evidence that it is just as transmissible with older kids. So when you start getting to 12-year-olds and 13-year-olds, the disease is more easily transmitted as it is with adults. And that definitely seems to have more conclusive evidence to it. So I do worry more about, one, they are big, our middle schools, almost 800 kids, or our high schools over 1,000. And again, very complicated to meet those standards. And again, questioning whether it's better or not. Claudia, I think the best for the community, wait, we have one case. Yeah, I know that there definitely is concern about what happens when there's an exposure. And I think that it's likely that there could be an infection in school. I don't want to pretend and tell you that, like, doing all of this will protect everyone. There is the possibility of that. And there is the possibility of and some school districts that are smaller in other parts of the state have had some success with in-person and haven't had infections yet. But because we are in the most populous county in the state, that makes it more complicated. If a teacher has a partner, will they also be given the vaccine? No, they won't. Only educators will be in this next sequence. Frankly, I don't know how they're going to know, but one of the things that teachers and staff will be receiving in the coming weeks is they'll actually get a link from the provider that's giving the vaccine to make an appointment, because we, this past week, have been providing information about the number of staff that we have. Our partners, like all of our culturally specific partners, will also be eligible for the vaccine, but depending on partners and spouses' occupation, is really dependent on when they would be eligible for the vaccine. What's the risk to older households? Yeah, Michael, that there's risk. There's risk. And when the community spread is higher, that risk is greater. Again, I'm not a public health expert, but I think it's fair that I could say that there's risk to families. You know, I grew up in a household with my grandmother. And, you know, I would assume that, you know, any multi-generational home or older parents who have are at risk with their health, that is a factor. I do not think that there's been a lot of conclusive studies about spread to the home, right? Most of the studies have been about transmission in the school. Like one kid comes to school who has the virus and then gives it to a staff member or gives it to another student. I don't think that there's conclusive studies about how it contributes to the spread in the broader community. Stacy, are there concerns about family members who are classified as high risk of our students and staff? I'm concerned about bringing it back to our families. Yeah, me too. I'm concerned about it. It's one of my biggest concerns. And part of our, you know, part of listening and hearing your questions tonight, because this is definitely something I've heard from a lot of folks in the community. Cody, yeah, I mean, your question is a really good question. And I think about going back to the previous question about youngest students. One of the things we are doing right now and plan that we are working on is, are there ways for us to bring students back in a limited capacity, particularly students who we know are needing additional help? And that's not just during the school year, it is also considering what can we do in the summer months for families that are able to receive additional support? And more importantly, like what can we do next school year? As restrictions loosen, we are gonna have to ramp up how we serve our kids. But I also wanna be careful about that. I know that our kids are desperate just for the social attention and are gonna just wanna play with their friends and at the same time, help them and support them with their academics and catching up to where they need to be. Annie, about next year, boy, you know, I am really hopeful. I am really, really hopeful. And I just don't know where things will go. I feel like the fact that there is a vaccination and it's proven to be effective is going to give us a much better chance of having a more typical school year next year. I think there will still be restrictions. I'm hopeful they're not as restrictive, but I'm really hopeful and I'm committed to keeping you informed as we make decisions. Cody, I love your idea. I'm actually a big fan of the idea of having more consecutive time in school. I actually, prior to the pandemic, was having some broader conversations with folks in our district about what it would look like if we had less time off in between, right, and spread the school year out throughout. So what I can promise you is I won't give up on that idea. And I actually think that there are obviously two critical things. One is funding. School funding is critical to make a change to the school calendar. Every day that we add to the school year is dollars that we need to pay the wonderful people that do the difficult work of teaching and loving and taking care of our kids at school. What happens when if teacher? Yeah, teach. I can say, I mean, I can't speak for all teachers, but I think our staff is really, really uncomfortable, right? Our administrators are uncomfortable. It's really challenging to determine at what point do we. We're all going to enter a stage where we're not fully comfortable. I do think the vaccinations will help build confidence, and more importantly, that confidence is coming from something that's actually. That we can feel and that there's more immunity in the community. I think that I can speak for myself as a member of the staff in Park Rose. I worry about the impact that I could potentially have on someone's life because it does come down to humanity first, and that heart breaks my heart because what keeps me up at night are those questions that we're getting from families about how do we get our kids back? Because my, you know, my kid's really struggling. So that comfort level, our conversation in Park Rose right now is that what are the factors we want to have in place that at least builds a higher level of comfort? I think that everyone will experience some level of discomfort. We have nutrition staff, custodians, some of our principals, some of our teachers going into buildings now. And I know that there's a lot of nervous folks about these decisions. So academic outcomes and learning progress being measured. So at the elementary level, we have assessments that we're using currently. So elementary families and middle school families will have conferences in early March. And at that time, we'll be able to talk with families about progress, and we'll actually be able to measure progress against what we say the norms are, you know, for a grade level. And that does help us determine who is really falling behind and who needs just a little bit of additional help. But that'll be an important time for families to learn. We do not know about state level testing. We have applied in our state for a waiver to not take the standardized test this year. We feel like taking a standardized test would not be great information for us. I think the best information we can gather right now is the systems that we're using at school. And then when kids do return to school, you know, doing assessments to determine how we can meet them where they are and help them catch up. If the shift to hybrid happens, are we placing students whose families aren't in a position to return to school at a disadvantage, a lower quality? Yeah, Lisa, I'm worried about that. I don't want to tell you that it's going to be lower quality, but we simply face the conflict of how much do we ask our teachers to do and our educational assistants and other staff, our administrators, because they will be serving and teaching in two different ways. So that is really difficult to measure. There are some districts, and I just want to kind of be open that we've looked at this possibility, but we just think that I feel like it puts our kids at a disadvantage that purchase an online curriculum that really lacks a teacher. And I think that definitely puts our kids at a disadvantage. And so I'm not a big fan of spending district money on an online curriculum that really would have to be managed mainly by families and less so by teachers. And so we're trying to find the balance of, and if it's 50-50, for instance, if 50% of our families say, I'm coming back, and 50% say, I'm not coming back, we always have to have the door open for if a family gets comfortable and says, I want to come back. So teachers have to be prepared to have their, you know, their full class. There's some questions in the Q&A. Justin, they won't be mandatory for school staff, but we're advising staff to get the vaccine. Obviously that does help us. Will there be any sports? Depending on the sport. So I mentioned earlier, soccer and cross country for the fall sports, their season technically begins February 22nd. So those two sports can be played because they're outside and we can manage the contact tracing for that. Volleyball and football right now won't be allowed because we're not allowed to bring sporting events inside. So those rules may change because lots of rules have been changing. But right now, football doesn't look great. They are going to start conditioning. They will, in a couple of weeks, make some decisions about whether, but football can't be played while the county is an extreme, which is what our current risk level is in our county, is extreme. Baseball will be played. I think baseball and softball both have a good chance of being played in the spring. Yeah, your question about would it be wiser as a small community like us to finish the year online? It's a really good question. It's a fair question. I think what we really want to know further from families is, you know, like those families who are really, really impacted and struggling right now, you know, what can we do for them? And I want to be thoughtful as we go. We did extend, you know, our district is one of just a handful of districts that decided to wait. I did not want our district to be the first in line, honestly, because I just don't, I still feel like it's a bit experimental. And I don't have confidence that the community spread is low enough for us to start. And that's just my feeling. That's my feeling for our community. The metrics help, but they aren't going to, you know, be the sole thing that decides this. You are absolutely right. This community has been disproportionately impacted by COVID-19. Our Pacific Islander families, our Latino families, our Black families, in particular, have seen really high rates of infection, and that really concerns me. John, yes, there is the possibility of opportunities for summer school if conditions have improved. The great thing about that is we could do some things outside. We're working with our community partners to see you know, one of the things I hope for is just getting our kids opportunities to be together, right? Like bringing them together, because the routine of getting back into the classroom is going to be probably a little nervous, particularly for the younger kids, of getting back into a whole new routine. I'm really hopeful, John, that we will have programs in the summer that can help support our kids. Our community at high risk, how much out of school left? Yeah. Yeah, it's a good question. That question about like, wouldn't it be better to finish school year online? I think to be fair to our community and to our staff, I know that it's really important to have some level of certainty in a really uncertain time. And so I will be working with our district and our staff over the next few weeks to really help answer that question. And to be honest with you, I am anxious and concerned about another spike. And if that other spike occurs, I think that does influence decision-making about what we might do in the spring. Judy, what kind of federal funding has been assigned for COVID relief and will it contribute? Yeah, so we have received some funds. The very first CARES Act that was passed in the spring, that did allow us to pay for Chromebooks for students, all of the personal protection equipment for staff that is there and ready for when we are in person. There were, you know, millions of dollars of costs that were not costs we typically are used to. And some of that funding has helped pay for those needs. About 500 hotspots. So families who have hotspots, we've leased those hotspots for a year. We believe that we're gonna need to extend some of those leases. So the second round of the most recent federal relief is on its way. And that's where, you know, for instance, we've spent hundreds of thousands of dollars on nutrition, but because not all the kids are at school, sadly, the school district doesn't get reimbursed for all of, you know, the lack of meals that we're serving, because we're not serving enough meals to families because we don't have all the kids coming to pick up food. So that's an example of one place where the district has lost money and we have to use that federal relief to help continue feeding our kids and our families. So we're hopeful that this next round of relief will help make up for some losses that we've already incurred. And then the other pieces we'll be looking at, like going back to John's question, summer school, extended support for students and staff. Will be how we would focus on spending those monies. Ventilation is a big factor. So we're also looking at and doing an analysis of, do we need to increase to the maximum you know, ventilation protection throughout our district? That's really, really costly. The federal relief won't cover all of that, but it will surely help us work on it. COVID testing within the school. So COVID testing within the school, and that's if, you know, I say if, because we don't actually have the rapid tests now. It is the rapid test. I don't know if any of you in the audience have taken the rapid test, but it is a it's a self-administered test. It's not the nasal swab. It would be monitored by staff at school, likely office staff, if and when we would start. Will permission be obtained ahead of time? Yeah, if any student is suspected of being infected, families contacted and then contacted, of course, by the nurse. So our nursing staff would be guiding our staff in, you know, determining whether or not a student is tested. And again, the rapid tests are not nearly as reliable as the regular test. So what it does for a school is it allows us to see like, okay, this initial test showed an infection. So we need to trace back and see who this kid's been in contact with, so we can make determination about how we handle quarantines for students and staff. So this would not be regular testing like you see with professional athletes and, you know, other professions where people are getting tested daily. This would be in the case where we suspected an infection in the school or in a student. How about the nutrition EBT cards? I know Cherie's in the audience. Hey, Andrea, could you make Cherie a panelist? And she might be able to answer that question, which if you don't know what nutrition EBT cards are, last year families who were at schools that were what we call community eligible that received free and reduced lunch, they actually received food credit through an EBT card from the state. So Cherie, you know anything about that?
A little bit, and it's still in the works of what they're going to do in the future with it. It's not dead in the water, but they're still looking at it. So I can get back with you once I know more, but it's pretty hard right now from the state's department to get an answer.
Thanks, Cherie. Appreciate that. There's baseball question mark. Yeah, baseball. I think baseball has a good chance. Again, as long as there's not a severe spike, I think baseball, because it's an outside sport and is not a high contact sport, has a good chance for kids to participate. Is there support for seniors who might be struggling? So one of the things I know our high school and middle school is working on is a plan. One thing our district can do that I want to reiterate is we can in CDL, we can start to bring students back in short periods of time, up to 2 hours a day, to support students like a senior who needs credit recovery or who needs assistance in class. So one of the first things we will do as we start to see a more rapid decline in community spread is we will start to bring students on campus that is not, you know, it's not hybrid instruction, it's not actually instruction, it's just support for specific students. So at the very least, if we were to stay in CDL, we would still be bringing some students back over time in what we call limited in-person instruction. And again, I do think that will ramp up and be more comprehensive, meaning we can offer it at all the schools at a higher level once our staff has had opportunity to be vaccinated. Will staff be allowed the choice of staying CDL when we return to hybrid in-school learning? The only choice, Pam, is if the employee is deemed at risk by their medical doctor. That's where we support and will allow folks to work from home. However, the choice piece is tough. We need our employees to feel safe and comfortable, but at the same time, we are going to reach a point, even if it's the beginning of next year, where we're entering a new era of school where COVID still exists and we don't have full community immunity. It really is just a matter of when that happens. And part of what I'm doing with a smaller district team that will include classified staff and certified staff is asking, like, what are the conditions we are most comfortable with? And not only for our community, but for our staff to return. Right now, most districts, what you'll see is like it's voluntary. Like if a staff wants to come and help, they can. But right now, it's not required. Will we be communicating to families what hybrid would look like? Yes. First, we'll be asking families the question about what their intent is. And alongside that will be like, this is what school would look like. You know, these listening sessions are an example of, here's what school would look like in general, 2 days per week. I don't think that we could fairly maximize it to 3 or 4 just simply because we don't have the space. The question about getting together for fun day, I would really love, one of the best ideas I've heard recently from one of our high school administrators was the idea of doing summer opportunities for kids to get together and simply play and connect with their peers from class. We're hopeful to be able to provide some of those opportunities. And honestly, if things are more safe in the spring, there's nothing that would keep us from providing that, to a certain limit, right? Just depends on the number of kids that would participate. There's a question, and if an outbreak happens, how will children that go into quarantine get caught up or attend? What we would provide for students in quarantine is they would just have to have distance learning like we're doing now. Again, like I mentioned earlier, the challenge of that is what does that distance learning look like? You know, who's the teacher that's connecting with your child? And making sure that they're staying engaged at school. But we would be obligated to provide service at home through distance learning if a student is quarantined. Savannah, will there be outdoor school program for sixth graders? I know that the ESDs are trying to do a distance learning outdoor schools. I would love and will be advocating for our sixth graders to be able to get outdoor school when we have a more normal school environment, because that is one of the tragedies of last school year and this school year, is that, you know, typical outdoor school is not planned or happening because of the risks. I sure hope there's a way for our community to come together and make that happen. Sheree, go ahead and share if you have a comment.
I just got a text. The Oregon has not been approved for additional months on the EBT card. So I just got the note from nutrition.
Thank you. Are there any further questions? Do let folks know if you found this to be helpful. We'll be doing another one in a few weeks. And in a few weeks, we'll know a little bit more. So obviously I would invite you to come back if you want to stay part of the conversation, because what you're sharing with us tonight is really, really, really helpful. Do you think high school or maybe middle school will integrate remote learning in a normal school year like some colleges are? Yeah, Michael, that actually is a really good question. I think education is, in the long run, is going to be better, simply because I think we can diversify more in terms of what kids can access. I think about students who have broader interests beyond, you know, even some of the electives we may be able to offer, and how can we work regionally, even statewide, to provide online opportunities. Because I will say that distance learning is really hard. It's hard for kids, it's hard for teachers, but I know that some of our kids are actually thriving and actually do better in this environment than the typical school environment. So I would really like to encourage and hope for some balance that there will be remote opportunities. We're better equipped for it, but I think as we think about how we staff our district and support our kids, I think that's a really important long-term vision question that you're asking, and I appreciate you bringing it up. Anything? Thank you for the thank yous. Thank you for your patience and your grace. It's really been a tough year for all of us, and I appreciate you all coming tonight.
Michael, I'm sorry, there was one more question from Stacey Danfarma near the end.
All right, I'll go back and see if I can find it.
I can read it out loud.
Go for it.
How much time would be spent on transitioning to hybrid since students would have to learn all new routines and expectations? Thinking about students who need extra support with grade level content and wanting to support them as much as possible.
Stacy, my best guess to that answer is we would likely give teachers a week for preparing for the change, meaning that would just be preparation and planning. And then we probably would be reaching out, particularly to primary teachers like yourself, and asking, you know, like, how do we kind of stage so that kids can come back? You know, obviously, I don't think that all families would choose to come back. So class sizes would be pretty small and starting, but we aren't going to, we would definitely at least take a week to 10 days where we would have to figure out a way to provide some asynchronous work to students and then, you know, allow for teachers to start making that shift. The big question, Stacy, is how do we attend to both? And I don't have a really strong answer for how we would do that. Some school districts that are doing hybrid across the country, their teachers are sitting in front of a camera while some kids are at home and some kids are in person, which does limit your ability to really make as much of an impact on the in-person part because you're having to attend to both. And I know that probably makes your head explode, but that's what some districts are doing. And that doesn't mean what we're doing, but that's what we're, that's the challenge. All right, any other questions? All right, thanks so much, everybody. I appreciate you taking time out of your evening to come visit with us, and I really appreciate you sharing your thoughts and your questions. Good night. Sarah, I